Related racial concerns attacked by Henry James, W. E. Boys. Oh, wow. Where'd that go? Okay, there we go. And William Dean Howells warns black and white strangers aim to, quote, force scholars on the cultural right to explain that which they now simply assert, in part. In his second book, So Black and Blue, Warren shows us yet another cost of defending ideas of black cultural difference by pointing out the similarities between depictions of the supposedly pathological black underclass offered by the sociologist William Julius Wilson on one hand and the literary scholar Henry Louis Gates on the other. Both enable the survival of a stereotype. Warren writes, "The open handshake between Gates and Wilson suggests that the disparaging depictions of impoverished black Americans associated with sociology have persisted not in spite of, but paradoxically, in part because of literary men. Gates' certainty that the major task facing black literary scholarship in the 1980s was locating those features that produced black difference and distinctiveness had one logical corollary. The survival of black criticism required the survival of black difference. Scholars were enjoined to account for the historical, or as in Gates' case, the textual emergence of group distinctiveness, and the accounting for difference subtly shaded over into the act of reproducing difference. Not because scholars intended to reproduce inequality, but rather because the reproduction of distinctive group practices and culture as objects of study has enabled scholars to do the things that scholars do. Just as the fate of the Negro during the 20th century as an object of public policy and social programs had been determined largely by scholarly and intellectual practices, so have these same practices been largely dependent on the emergence and persistence of the Negro." End quote. And of course, no one who has read Warren's most challenging work, What Was African American Literature, can forget how he spells out the stakes of extending African American literature, which he defines as a representational and rhetorical strategy that developed in response to the specific conditions of Jim Crow, beyond its historical moment and into the present. Here, last quote, is the climax to his devastating analysis of Michael Thomas's novel from 2007, Man Gone Down. To put the matter in broader terms, the idea that sustains the possibility of an African-American literature is a belief that the welfare of the race as a whole depends on the success of black writers and those who are depicted in their texts. And while the argument of the foregoing volume has attempted to reveal the crumbling scaffolding beneath this idea, the hyperbolic recrudescence of the belief in Man Gone Down also demonstrates why the idea of an African-American literature persists. Those who write it and those who write about it need it to distinguish the personal odysseys that they undertake to reach personal success from similar endeavors by their white class peers. Post-Jim Crow literature that adopts the rhetorical strategies of African-American literature, Warren argues, uses the idea of black difference. Here, a necessary precondition of, quote, race group interests as a cover to advance the interests and ambitions of a certain branch of the American elite, the black professional managerial class. As the equally insightful political scientist Adolf Reed is fond of saying, there is no opposition between identity politics and class politics. Identity politics is a class politics. Hopefully this somewhat lengthy, but as I see a necessary introduction and exploration of Warren's work makes it clear why we've invited him here today. No one has done a finer job of laying out the stakes of race-based literary and cultural criticism. No one is better equipped to reflect on the political implications of literary studies in our current moment and to invite us to consider what we are really defending when we take up certain positions in contemporary critical debates about art and language. And we are honored to have him, along with Joshua Gang and Lee Claire LaVerge, here with us today for our symposium. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Fairfax M. Cone Distinguished Service Professor of Literature at the University of Chicago, Kenneth Warren.
Representation and some of them, and then I got the invitation.
you like to talk about terms? And I said, yes.
And as I said in the notes to the piece, and I'm just going to give it more or less as I sent it to you, that this is a kind of distillation of a progress. It actually ends up, it wasn't meant to center on African-American literature of the 1950s, sort of in the closing couple of decades of the period of African-American literature. It was really meant to be a broader reflection on novels of that period as such. But I think that by distilling it in the way that I have, I'm able to make some claims that I hope are resonant with respect to the larger issues of the novel. And as I said, the current book, the title of the book is From Representation to Expression, A Brief Episode in the History of the Novel, which is actually coming from a little too much, even though I'm trying to limit it a bit. Let me begin. Proposing to take up the question of representation for this symposium, I was prompted by what seemed to me to be a relatively circumscribed literary historical matter, namely the relative shift during the mid-20th century in discussions of African-American novels from, on the one hand, insisting that black writers must rise above what was seen as their particular grievances to write about the human condition more generally. From that, too, on the other hand, asserting rather vigorously that the task of the black writer and artist was, rather than to focus on universality, to express a black particularity unavailable to writers who were not, to quote W.E.B. Du Bois, bone of the bone, flesh of the flesh, and the veil of the veil. The first sentiment could be expressed condescendingly, let's say, by outsiders, such as when William Faulkner remarked that Richard Wright might potentially be a great artist, provided his work could get beyond the kind of racial complaint that, as literature will, quote, accomplish little of what it should accomplish, since only they will be moved and grieved by it who already know and grieve over this situation. But such sentiments could also come from insiders like Wright himself, who, in his famous essay, The Blueprint for Negro Writing, after chiding past efforts by most black writers as not yet having produced much beyond, quote, humble novels, poems, and plays, prim and decorous ambassadors who went a-begging to white America, he called upon black writers instead to learn to view the life of a Negro living in New York's Harlem or Chicago's South Side with the consciousness that one-sixth of the earth belongs to the working class. As for the second imperative, the multitude of black arts and black aesthetic texts, imperative that is to say to express black particularity, emerging during the 60s, which also, paradoxically, in my argument, attends the end of African-American literature as such, can be deduced of the evidence of the ongoing project of expressing particularity. To be sure, versions of this debate were coincident with the birth and development of African-American literature from the 1890s forward, and my claim to conducting a somewhat limited inquiry can thus be kind of disputed right out of the gate. But the shift in the period that I'm pointing to has been amply noted by other scholars in various ways. For example, Richard H. King's book, Race, Culture, and the Intellectuals, 1940 to 1970, argues that a universalist vision defined by a hope that racial and cultural differences would fade in light of the assumption that all races enjoyed equal capabilities and aspirations achieved consensus in the post-war period only by the 1960s to give way to cultural particularism in which the cultivation of racial or ethnic consciousness rather than colored by universalism, seemed increasingly more compelling. King's chronology, set alongside the account of, say, nativist modernism as the dominant literary mode of the 1920s, as Walter Good Michaels argues in The Shape of the Signifier, suggests that it might be useful to see the historical moment of African-American literature, which is roughly the 1890s through the 1960s, as corresponding with a period defined by a contestation between, on the one side, black writers asserting an indiscriminate right to represent whatever they chose without respect to social identity, and on the other, insisting on the imperative of expressing black distinctiveness. So the period of African-American literature is defined by the contestation between these two positions, and the period ensuing in the aftermath of this moment could then be defined, and this would be, say, the rise of the Black Aesthetic Black Arts Movement, by the resolution of that debate in favor of the project of distinctiveness and particularity, or what Michaels would call the triumph of the subject position as such. And while at cursory glance, an insistence on the primary of expressiveness or subject position may appear to be refiguring the idea of something like the innumerable watchers at the windows of Henry James's House of Fiction, the ideas reflect actually competing ontologies of literary texts. For James, in this famous preface to Portrait of a Lady, these apertures are on the world are, what he says, but windows at the best, mere holes in a dead wall, disconnected, perched aloft. And the dramatic setting of the metaphor, of his metaphor, is scenic. Before each window stands a figure with a pair of eyes, or at least with a field glass, which forms again and again for observation a unique instrument, ensuring to the person making use of it an impression distinct from any other. James continues, he and his neighbors are watching the same show, but one seeing more where the other sees less, one seeing black where the other sees white, one seeing big where the other sees small, one seeing coarse where the other sees fine, and so on and so on. There is fortunately no saying on what for the particular pair of eyes the window may not open. Fortunately, by reason, precisely of this incalculability of range, the spreading field, the human scene is the choice of the subject. Pierced aperture, either broad or balcony or slit-like and little proud, is the literary form. But they are singly or together as nothing without the posted presence of the watcher, without, in other words, the consciousness of the artist. So that's James. By contrast, and this takes Erica Edwards is making something of a representative statement here, the metaphors drawn upon in the attempt to underwrite a collective identity for black authored fiction of the post-Jim Crow era tends to draw upon the idea of instruments that measure external effects upon the psyche or the sensorium. As Edwards writes, and this is in contrast to the scenic visual metaphors of the Jamesian passage that I read, writes in an analysis of post 9/11 fiction by black writers, quote, these texts reflect how black literature bears the imprint of domestic policy securitization through preemptive war, torture, and incarceration, while at the same time refusing the logic of these policies. That is, they ask us to consider the psychic and physical cost of Americanization, not only on black subjects in the US, but also on black and brown subjects of the US around the globe. On this line, such texts are not so much representations of what one purports to have seen or experienced, but rather, to revise slightly what I said a few sentences ago, something more like the sensorium itself, reacting almost organically to the world, rather than producing representations of it. These reactions, to be sure, are not seen merely as passive, but resistant, making the literary text or art object in some sense an extension of this resistant reaction. Before going further, I should acknowledge again, as I said, that this transition from representation to expression in relation to discussions of black author texts from the period of African American literature through its aftermath did not occur solely or even primarily within this domain, but reflected the way in which this writing has participated in the broader project of anti-foundationalism that became a preoccupation of the academy during the last third of the 20th century. In literary and philosophical terms, the upshot was that the sense that the focus on the relation between language and reality must be abandoned, and along with it, the idea that texts, particularly novels, could be understood as representing a pre-existing reality. In the wake of representation came, of course, social constructivism, some would say pure relativism, more negatively, and the host of debates accompanying these shifts, the terms of which were so quickly established that by 1993, when George Levine published his edited volume, Realism and Representation, Essays on the Problem of Realism in Relation to Science, Literature, and Culture, he recalled that one reviewer of a proposal for the conference that produced the essays for the volume responded with an alarming lack of sympathy. Migo, he or she contemptuously, contemptuously wrote, which is to say, my eyes glaze over, to indicate that indicate the belief that little was to be gained from a debate in which positions taken seemed to be predetermined, and everybody knew what was at stake. However, notwithstanding the underwhelming response from this one reviewer, Levine soldiered on in his effort to establish some measure of rapprochement between the epistemological and the anti-epistemological orientations of scientists and literary critics, respectively, as well as between those literary critics who wanted to hang on to the mimetic or constitutive functions of the novel and those who insist on, rather, on its constructivist or performative aspects. Indeed, even many of the anti-foundationalist theories in the volume seem to be committed to, as J. Hillis Miller argues in his contribution to Levine's volume, seeing mimetic realism as reflection and critique of ideology is yet another displaced reinscription of the Platonic paradigm, whereby constitutive representation and constitutive performative language are irreconcilably mixed, recapitulation and evocation. In realistic fiction, any time or place in our tradition, the projected groundless phantasm and the genuine reproduction of the real occur in a single indistinguishable operation of narrating language. So kind of like, he's still pushing that anti-foundational line, but I think doing so in a way that suggests its openness to some of the claim of an almost necessary foundationalism, at least is how I read that. Part of the point of my brief peregrination through the terrain of this larger debate is to make clear that my point in marking the shift from the representative to the expressive in discussing Black authored fiction is not to contrast relatively naive commitments to realism with relatively striking commitments to a consensual anti-realism. Rather, what I want to see in the displacement of realism, that is to say representation, is something like a project of displacing the work of art itself as a concern in and of itself, in favor of effacing any difference between text, which is to say artwork, and the world. The point here is that whatever count one has of the relationship between the text as work of art and the world, simply to raise the question of that relation is to raise the question of representation and its possibility, even if only ultimately to dismiss it. On the contrary, the insistence on the continuity of the literary and the non-literary prevents the question of representation from rising at all by making the literary merely another aspect of the it's just sort of what we do. So ultimately, and so as Candace M. Jenkins puts it, writing about African American literature, as she sees it, ultimately resistance and even outright refusal might be one key to the Black literary endeavor in the 21st century, but magic is another. The current socio-political circumstances under which we are writing, reading, and thinking about literature suggest as much. Black life, which lies after all at the center of Black literary and cultural production, is in this moment bounded by vulnerability, by death's ubiquitous proximity, as well as by resilience, everyday wonder, and deliberate joy. To be Black in the contemporary moment is thus to be shaped by profoundly contradictory but mutually constitutive experiences to which our literature gives complex voice, not alone, but in concert with numerous other media, creating a truly heterogeneous and often downright astonishing cultural landscape. The ease with which Jenkins slides from literature to life and from one media to another without pausing at all to consider mediation is suggestive here. As a goal, as I read this, Blackness is something like the dream of the immediate. By way of contrast, one can take Ralph Ellison's 1957 reflections on novelistic practice in his essay, Society, Morality in the Novel, which at every turn is concerned with marking and overcoming the difference between artist and audience, vision and world, vision of the world as well as art and society. Ellison writes that, that by its nature, the novel seeks to communicate a vision of experience. Therefore, whatever else it achieves artistically, it is basically a form of communication. When successfully communicating its experience, that magic thing occurs between the world of the novel and the reader. Indeed, between reader and reader in their mutual solitude, which we know as communion. As with all fictive arts, the novel's medium of communication consists in a familiar experience occurring among a particular people within a particular society or nation. Parenthetically, he says the novel is bound up with the notion of nationhood, and it achieves its universality, if at all, through accumulating images of reality and arranging them in patterns of universal significance. It is not, like poetry, concerned primarily with words, but with action depicted in words, and it operates by amplifying and giving resonance to a specific complex of experience until, through the eloquence of its statement, that specific part of life speaks metaphorically for the whole. So however frequently Ellison evokes that which is familiar, along with notions of shared being in this passage, he remains primarily committed to the idea of the novelistic work as fictive, involved in patterning, arranging, and deploying rhetorical figures in order to achieve its ends. Tellingly, both Ellison and Jenkins resort to the idea of magic in describing the goal of literary practice, but the inflections could hardly be more different. For Ellison, magic seems to indicate successful communication, which is to say, mediation. For Jenkins, as she glosses the term in the footnote, the referent is primarily experiential. She says, quote, "My invocation of magic here is meant both as a nod to the popular hashtag Black Girl Magic and as a gesture towards something more expansive, the allure of enchantment and pleasure of blackness." The chief point here lies in seeing the question of representation as entailing a consideration of the work of art as, in important ways, discontinuous with what it purports to represent or be about, so that the question of its relation to that aboutness can properly be raised. And to clarify this stipulation, I'd like to shift gears here to some observations drawn from art history. Although it would be stretching the truth to say that since its publication in 1967, Michael Fried's Art and Objecthood has figured centrally in discussions of African-American art and literature. It doesn't require too much effort to see how, to quote Fried, the imperative that modern art defeat or suspend its objecthood is at bottom the imperative that it defeat or suspend theater. How that might be cognate with much of what has preoccupied at least one strain of thinking about Black art and literature since the late 19th century. One need only mention the way that the specter of minstrelsy loomed over the career of Paul Laurence Dunbar to see the broad outlines that make that comparison at the idea that the Black person is always necessarily theatricalized. Although in Dunbar's case, the problem would not be appropriately described as a problem of modernism, the matter that concerned him was nonetheless the more fundamental one that we described in Art and Objecthood, namely the threat theatricality posed in the very idea of art. When Dunbar bemoans the world's praise for, quote, "a jingle in a broken tongue," he's not only objecting to the strictures on the mode within which the Black writer was expected to work, inevitably the comic, but rather the belief that in truth no real line existed between the dialect poem on the page and the banter of the Black laborer in the cotton field. To indulge a slight anachronism, what Dunbar was objecting to was the type of sentiment that the sociologist Robert Park offered up a few decades later in an article that would infuriate Ralph Ellison, namely the observation that for the claim that the Negro is, quote, "primarily an artist loving life for its own sake. His métier is expression rather than action. The Negro is, so to speak, the lady among races." On Park's description of black poetry and art, the line between art and life simply disappears, such that all utterance and representation becomes nothing other than expression. Paradoxically, this could appear to make the figure of the Negro a figure of a peculiar side of absorption, of a certain kind of expression without rhetoric, an expression that need not acknowledge audience. Indeed, for Park, whose interest from the stance of sociology was in getting at something like the truth of black life, the lack of black self-consciousness in black folk poetry, in contradistinction to the kind of poetry that was emerging during the Harlem Renaissance, was valuable because it revealed exactly who the Negro was. For Park, the folk Negro in his milieu expresses himself, so to speak, unintentionally and unself-consciously. Getting at what art presumably gives us without going through art becomes a feature of what it means to think about black art forms, for which the commitment to form is at best minimal, giving way instead to a certain stylization, to the way one almost reflexively does things, to that which one can't help. In many ways, it is against the that which one can't help version of black art that much of Ralph Ellison's essays on black art and literature are pitched, of which perhaps the most well-known is his essay, The World and the Jug, where he asserts that while one can do nothing about choosing one's relatives, one can, as an artist, choose one's ancestors. Richard Wright was, in this sense, a relative. Hemingway, an ancestor. Langston Hughes, whose work I knew in grade school and whom I knew before I knew Wright, was a relative. T.S. Eliot, whom I was to meet only many years later, and Malraux and Dostoevsky and Faulkner's, were ancestors, if you please, or don't please. That which he can do nothing about is that which makes one's work, so to speak, black. A set of lived or imputed social relations, hence relatives, adduced to demarcate one group from another. It is here where a Parkian sociological interest lies. And in Ellison's estimation, it is this set of relations, so it would seem, that paradoxically matter the least for the black artist. Crucially important would be that which Fried calls conviction, specifically the conviction that a particular painting or sculpture or poem or piece of music can or cannot support comparison with past work within that art whose quality is not in doubt. For modernist art, for Fried and for Ellison, nothing short of conviction matters at all. To put the case more strongly would be to say that while what might initially compel interest in work is everything that one might want to collocate with blackness, for the black artist, by contrast, the point would be to overcome this interest so that what would ultimately stand forth is the conviction that this is a work of art. The conviction would not be to deny the force asserted on one's social being by those ascriptive practices by which races are constituted, but it would be to deny their precedence and to attenuate their consequence except as a question of how they matter within art. Now, I suspect that to some ears, this sounds perhaps a little more than an updating of what Langston Hughes alleged against the poet County Cullen in his landmark 1926 article, The Negro Artist and the Racial Mountain, when Hughes wrote, "One of the most promising of the young Negro poets said to me once, 'I want to be a poet, not a Negro poet.' Meaning, I believe, I want to write like a white poet. Meaning, subconsciously, I want to be a white poet. Meaning behind that, I would like to be white." And I was sorry the young man said that, for no great poet has ever been afraid of being himself. And I doubted then that, with his desire to run away spiritually from his race, this boy would ever be a great poet. But this is the mountain standing in the way of any true Negro art in America, this urge within the race toward whiteness, the desire to pour individuality into the mold of American standardization, and to be as little Negro and as much American as possible. But I hope what should become evident upon reperusing Hughes' slippery slope not a Negro poet, but poet, white, and so on, is that he has stipulated what needs instead to be argued, namely the apparently inescapable identity of race and poetry. The idea that to be a true poet, one must, from the standpoint of identity, be a particular kind of poet, or else produce only that which would come from the mold of American standardization as the two options, which one presumes could only be something like a non-poetry. Or to put it slightly differently, the problem he has identified is one that could not be, is one that cannot be wholly identified with a Negro poet, given that as it is formulated here, any path to poetry for an American artist would have to traverse the terrain of identity. What, according to Hughes, Cullen has missed is, as Michaels has demonstrated in Our America, that the great American modernist literature of the 1920s and 1930s succeeded precisely because, instead of evading the matter of race, it made identity its central project. So the crucial point that makes Ellison's remarks something other than a more artful restating of Cullen's insistence that the putative race of the artist should never matter for aesthetic judgment is here a historical one. Ellison's writing after the great achievements of 1920s nativism, modernism. For him, it is not enough to assert the irrelevance of race. Rather, he must demonstrate its overcoming. In his own fiction and in his broader discussions of American literature, this overcoming sometimes involves what Ellison saw as William Faulkner's method of beginning with the necessary theatricalization of race, the necessary theatricalization that race entails, which is mainly the stereotype, accepting it as true, and then seeking out the human truth which it hides. To be sure, much of Faulkner belongs with the corpus of nativist modernism, but for Ellison, Faulkner here serves as a guide to the idea that it is only the resources provided by art, properly understood, but for our purposes here, more important, or illuminating, maybe the brief reflections Ellison makes about the work of Romare Bearden, who was one of his most important artistic friends. Asked to provide the introduction to the 1967 catalog, Romare Bearden Paintings and Projections, Ellison took the occasion not to single out for a description a few exemplary works from the exhibition, which is actually one of the essay's limitations, but rather to lament what he saw as the overall challenge and achievement Bearden's work represented after he turned to collage in the early 1960s, when he discovered those methods that would allow him to express the tragic predicament of his people without violating his passionate dedication to art as a fundamental and transcendent agency for confronting and revealing the world. Ellison's essay proffers Bearden's achievement to the would-be black artist who cannot avoid, nor should he wish to avoid, his group identity, but flounders before the question of how his group's experience might be given statement through the categories of a nonverbal art form which has been consciously exploring its own unique possibilities for many decades before he appeared on the scene. Lacking any specifically Negro tradition of plastic design to offer him support, Ellison writes, the black artist feels, in brief, a near unresolvable conflict between his urge to leave his mark on the world through art and his ties to his group and its claims upon him. Now, I have no doubt that some might quibble with or reject outright the contention that black art or Bearden lacked any viable tradition of plastic design, but I want to just pass over that for now, in order to focus on what Ellison wants to assert is the crucial line of battle, namely Bearden's claiming for art that which had been dominated by non-art. Ellison asserts that by working with a highly conscious awareness of the resources and limitations of the form to which he has dedicated his creative energies, Bearden reveals a world long hidden by the cliches of sociology and rendered cloudy by the distortions of newsprint and the false continuity imposed upon our conception of Negro life by television and much documentary photography. Standing opposed to art, then, is along with Ellison's bête noir, sociology, the newspaper and documentary photo photography, in which bits and pieces figure, which in bits and pieces actually figure onto the surface of Bierman's collages. In Bierman's words, I feel that when some photographic detail, such as a hand or eye, is taken out of its original context and is fractured and integrated into a different space and form configuration, it acquires a plastic quality it did not have in the original photograph. Although Bierman began his career as a serious artist under the spell of the idea that, quote, art was an instrument of social change, his mature injunctions include such observations that, quote, a quality of artificiality must be retained in the work of art, since after all, the reality of art is not to be confused with that of the outer world. But to this he adds with a self-deprecatory ruefulness, I am afraid, despite my intentions, that in some instance commentators have tended to overemphasize what they believe to be the social elements of my work. But while my response to certain human elements is as obvious as it is inevitable, I am also pleased to note that upon reflection, many persons have found that they were as much concerned with the aesthetic implications of my paintings as with what may possibly be my human compassion. Although it's not quite right to say that the social element in Bierman's work stands against its aesthetic implications, it does seem clear that what Bierman and Ellison through him want is work that commands attention as an aesthetic object rather than as a political statement. Indeed, for Ellison, the political statement that he was chiefly interested in making, which was to affirm, quote, the irrelevance of the notion of race as a limiting force in the arts, could only be made via work that commands conviction as a work of art. Now, I want to make a brief closing observation, which will, as I make it, betray the limited nature of my treatment of these issues here. It must be reiterated that despite the prominence of both Bierman and Ellison in African art and literature, the strain of aesthetic reflection they represent is hardly the dominant one in these discourses. Rather, as represented by examples such as Fred Moten's The Case of Blackness, which made several explicitly anti-Friedman moves, for many Black writers and critics, the work of art that sees itself primarily as a work of art has been an occasion for suspicion and critique. Describing himself as, quote, blowing up Michael Fried from way downtown, way outside, Moten seeks to align the force of what he calls Blackness with theatricality, sociality, and community, a kind of overrunning of any norms that would seek to make the art, work of art, adequate to itself. The point of skirmish for Moten is not to distinguish between art and non-art, but rather how to conceptualize what Black art purports to represent, which is to say something like black lived experience, and to bring into play those places in which Black art hopes to find its audience. What's at stake, according to Moten, is fugitive movement in and out of the frame, bar, or whatever externally imposed social logic, a movement of escape, the stealth of the stolen that can be said, since it adheres in every closed circle to break every enclosure. So clearly more needs to be said here, as I've only given a vague outline of what Moten's essay does and how it tries to run its consideration of the problem of Blackness and the question of dwelling on and then minor social life in relation to the work of art. But the crucial move in this essay, this is where I'll end, is to refuse, even when one turns one's attention to it, to give the last word to the work itself.
And I guess I have a sort of larger question that I'd just be interested in hearing you reflect on in literary studies turn toward Michael Fried, I mean, which I think is just is quite interesting. And I would just be interested to hear you sort of suggest why you think that's happening now, and really what that tradition, which in many ways is out of fashion and it's sort of native ground of art history per se, can offer literature and why now. And then the second one is I'm just, and this is very speculative, but I'm just wondering, is there a role for the historical avant-garde here? Is that a term that we can use or that could offer something to the kind of analysis that you're suggesting?
Can I ask you just to say a little more about that last part?
I was just thinking of that comment that you gave by Robert Park, where he reads the Negro as always already an artist. There's no division between art and life for the race character at this moment. So this is the 1920s. This is when the European avant-garde is making a very similar claim, right? That the goal of art should be to destroy the category of art and to overcome this division. Obviously, they're making them in, you know, towards very different ends. But I'm just wondering, is there a potential for the history of the avant-garde, or the discourse of the avant-garde, to help us try to reconceive of what art means as a category in the way you're presenting it in this paper?
Okay.
Sorry, it's a lot.
No. Those are good questions. I'm not sure, but I'll see if I can do justice to them. Okay. With respect to the former, I can respond, somewhat, locally in terms of the circle in which I'm operating with, on non-site, where Fried has become kind of a crucial figure for thinking about think about the relationship of, some things that you're interested in, obviously, is in terms of aesthetics, to neoliberalism and the extension of capitalism as such, and to see that to sort of posit the possibility or the question or the problem of how does one see outside of or give a picture of the world outside of the pervasiveness of market relations under neoliberalization, which is to try to think about what it would mean to have something that responds to something other than the market as such. And there's a kind of account of what the work of art might be in this, right? Which is to say, it produces something like a formal relation. We're not talking about something you can take and march out into the street, right? But the idea would be that autonomy as formally provides a thought about how something might respond to a logic that it purports as necessary unto itself, right? As opposed to responding to the logics that comes from outside of itself. And so one way of thinking about the status of the aesthetic argument in the moment of post-structuralism, you say that the power there being everything becomes the possibility of everything else, but then when you flip that to the other side, it would be the dream of what the neoliberalization of the world might look like, right? Which is to say that everything can be produced in terms of market equivalences and the like. And so that extension of value, of market values throughout the domain of human experience could look like something like a world in which there could be nothing like an aesthetic object, which is because the claim of the aesthetic object would be that it is something that can, even for the purpose of just sort of a formal contemplation, constitute something that can be responsive to itself rather than. So it's to open up the space for thinking outside of and producing, something like a critical consciousness of what a world outside of this might look like. And so by that term then, part of what is powerful about Fried's account of what, say, minimalism means and the set of observations coming outside of that where there is no possibility of producing, it's sort of uninteresting to think about what the frame does in terms of constituting something in and of itself, to be rough account of what I think that the significance of that that emergence is. With respect to the avant-garde, I do think that when you think about, say, the powerful interventions in artistic practice, I'm thinking about art in the teens and 20s. There's sort of no gainsaying in some sense the kind of formal innovation or you could say the attack on formal innovation, or attack on form as a form of innovation that is produced at that moment. But I think the way if I'm hearing the question correctly, would respond to it is that this shows, I think, the need to sort of think in a precise historical way as one can, because what you're seeing sort of simultaneously at this moment would be the way in which a sort of, let's say, something like formal excellence produced at this moment, or say aesthetic excellence, or excellence that even challenged the aesthetic as such, is not necessary, doesn't line up with what one might think of as something like political progressiveness, right? Because the key would be that the insight of modernism as sort of the identity of the work with the medium, the identity of expression with identity, right, produces great work, but it's a beneath it also requires a commitment to something that looks like race as a kind of natural category, a way of aligning expression with identity as such. So for me, the kind of fascinating thing is to be able to mark what is aesthetically interesting and powerful at the same time that one understands that its social implications may not be something that one wants to embrace. So part of the idea here is that it's not always the case that one can sort of, line up that which really is sort of powerful and significant aesthetically, artistically, with the ideas that one would like to hold, beliefs that one would like to hold politically or ethically.
Follow as nicely on your question as I would like it to. I want to go back to the quotation from Ellison, where it talks about choosing, you can't, rather than relatives, you'd like to choose as ancestors.
Yes.
But being that you can't really choose your relatives, but right. You can choose your ancestor. So I'm interested in you, as somebody who embodies a very interesting position in the literary field, in African American and in American literature, and even in critical race theory and that kind of thing, just who are your ancestors? I think there's a pedagogical intent here. I mean, I feel that in every cohort, there's this tug of relatives. There's a sort of kind of work that you should do. There's a real. It's very difficult to resist unless you're just plain ornery when you're a graduate student. And I'm very interested in who are your ancestors? How do you embody this independent position that you're known for in this field, which I think is an incredibly powerful one?
That's a really interesting question. Because Ellison, who figures heavily in this piece, is someone with and against whom I thought, I think, for a long time. But I would say as well, in some sense, reading Auerbach's Mises was foundational in a certain kind of way. I think it's a kind of generational feature to that, perhaps, as well. So that's less of my independence, I think, in terms of responding to what's going on around one. And then it was really through a kind of Henry James seminar that I began trying to think through, because of the way in which I was seem to be relatively sort of throwaway references to the social world, which included the racial dimension, and the relative lack of commentary of that within James' criticism, and the way in which his novels were often taken at that moment as the kind of the exemplary instance of the aesthetic as such, right? The way in which you really get the novel to be a matter of its formal commitments. And I wanted to see, it seemed to me on that reading that those things seemed to be crucially connected. And so from that began a kind of, I would say, undisciplined, perhaps somewhat eclectic because of disciplined, tour through various scholars who I thought were interestingly trying to think through the relationship between the social and the formal, the historical, the formal, and economic, and the formal. I'd probably have to think more about it. Because it was not anything that was sort of a disciplined process, but the idea being that that mediation seemed to be a crucial thing to think about, so that one wouldn't be making crude claims about causality and the like. And while I found something like Bersani's work very powerful, I thought it was also some work that actually kind of ran past the idea of mediation in some sense by just simply producing something kind of like an identification go back to Josh's talk, it comes with the psychological and the literal. So I was literary, so I was always looking for moments where those things produced a certain kind of tension.
So how did you, I mean, certainly you felt a lot of heat along the way. Resistance from your interlocutors and peers. I'm just interested in how you use the, you're doing something that, personally, I know aggravated a lot of people. You used Joshua's term, annoying. This criticism, I want to annoy. Anyway, I'm just interested in the position of yourself in a rather sort of brave place.
I don't
have to celebrate yourself.
I'm
wondering how
you
use.
I would
not
be my favorite. In some sense, I would say that there were moments when the people whose work I was most in conversation with in an antagonistic way were actually quite generous in their response to it, so that at the outset, the line that I was laying out against the kind of the vernacular line of criticism, I had early encounters with both Henry Louis Gates and Houston Baker, who simply said, you're disagreeing with us, but I like what you're doing. I like the way you're disagreeing with it. My first book actually appeared in Baker's very short-lived series. I don't think I killed it. It died shortly thereafter at the University of Chicago Press, and that was really at Houston's insistence. He really wanted it there. So, to a certain extent, if you're talking about graduate students, people can be mean and petty and all of that, but. It's sometimes surprising the extent to which, if you're honest in the way in which you're taking someone on, that even those who are at the receiving end of your criticism are actually happy because, one thing you want to get some attention and traction. Right? If somebody's disagreeing with you, at least they read you. and sometimes there's nothing worse than just the silence when something goes on. Happening to it, but I guess the other thing too is I do think, and I'm not sure how to characterize the moment now, but the early, that's not but to be like the late 80s, early 90s or whatever, seemed to me to be, and I don't know whether it was a feature of being in Chicago, but I get a sense that do this similar era, an environment that thrived on contestation. And so
that may have been idiosyncratic or whatever, but that was my feeling at the moment. So
well, actually, I would push it further on this. I would say that, you know, agreement, if you publish a book and everybody likes it, it's dead. That is true. You know, they all write nice reviews and no one is that. I mean, I just think that creating, I don't think you should go out of your way to annoy people, but it seems to me that your intervention was designed to change an argument that was thriving pretty well. And when you do that, you both honor the counter argument, the, you know, what you're arguing against, because you don't pick, you don't select out arguments that don't matter and that aren't well executed, not if you're smart. And you're also making it live along with your own. So anyway, it's sort of a, this is close that I come to morality, and I just wanted to.
Thank you. I think that was all about Nancy seeing a kindred spirit who irritates people and makes them change their mind.
If you're not irritated, you're deaf. You're
I wanted to ask him about the kind of cultural historical trajectory that you describe, where there's a shift from a kind of African-American or black realist tradition to an expressive tradition, which is a shift, as you describe it, from a representational tradition to an expressive tradition. And I may be wrong about this this kind of trajectory, but it seems to me that that's also coincident with a shift to an interest in historical novel and speculative novel in the African-American literary tradition. So that as realism loses force in a way, we end up with the African-American or black historical novel, we end up with the black speculative novel. And what's interesting to me is that both of those things, both of those genres are about trying to express something that often is thought of as actually not being there. That one of the problems, supposedly, of African-American history is that it's not there. So then, if that's the case, precisely what is it that you imagine yourself to be expressing if you were an African-American historical novelist trying to write in a way that is expressive of black life? And with the speculative novel as well, it's a world not yet, right? Or in the case of Octavia Butler, it's a world that has been, but is not now in certain cases. And I wonder, am I right? Do you think that there is a kind of coincidence of that shift toward expressivity with a shift toward historical novel on one hand and speculative on the other?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I have a piece that I've been working through. I'm not sure exactly how it fits in this project or whether it fits at all. It's been something of a standalone in which I do take up the rise of the historical novel, in which, and part of the claim there, right, is that there's that creates kind of an identification on the historical and speculative, right? That is to say, that the force of a historical novel for the tradition of African American writing, as you know it, is generated by the absence of the very history that it wants to document. That is to say, what generates a historical novel on these accounts, particularly those novels, it's a history that these novels are most interested in, to be something like the broader history of the Middle Passage, right? And that experience is marked by an absence of expressivity, that is to say, and history as such. You simply don't have the documents, you don't have the voices from that period in order then to engage in a process of representation as such, right? So what the historical novels, what these do is engage in kind of a speculative operation to sort of produce the conditions under which voices that aren't there, that we can't have access to, are understood as kind of speaking. And part of the force of that, in terms of what the demand made on the reader, and I do think that the demand here is meant to be a powerful one, is to kind of obliterate the difference between I am reading a novel, a fictionalized account of voices that are no longer there, blurring that, the line between that, and I'm actually allowing those voices to speak, right? As I say, I'm actually kind of engaged in something like a mystical operation that gives voice to those who don't have voice, and in some sense, moving the entire operation outside of the domain of what we might might think of as the aesthetic as such, right? Where at some level you're dealing with some version of the, you know, the representative, the as if, the thing that is available for some mode of appreciation, regardless of what you happen to believe to be the state of things relating into the world, that puts some pressure on you to see the operation deriving its value from its from the validity or the persuasiveness of its claim to speak for that which is not not there. So that there's a kind of, like I said, collapsing of the speculative onto the historical. I do think those things, and Butler would be a perfect case where you're really moving back and forth between the two, something like the recovery of the historical, the Simon's historical voice, and then moving into the, you know, that which does not yet exist as such. And to the extent that you get something like the, you know, as I'm understanding, the Afrofuturist commitment as something, right? The idea of positing something like the continuity of and the ongoing palpability of something that feels recognizably Black is actually secured the kind of claim of trans-historical reality, let's say, of that which is Black, which has to step outside of the very things. Because part of my point is that actually this new, sort of irritating people when I'm giving this as a talk, right? The claim was that all of these things don't count as novels. That they are certain kinds of historical romances and the like, but to the extent that one feature of novelization, as we've come to understand it, is that it provides a basis for something like social critique of the present and the past. These books can't do that because what they want to do is recuperate and to pay homage to and to align themselves with ancestral voices and the like. So they give up in terms of what they're centrally interested in. They give up the idea of sort of the critical edge, which is, you know, one account of what novelization might do. But that's also, you know, I'm imposing a fairly strict account of what genre is. But I, you know, in the talk that I've given, that I think is responsive to what you're saying. I do make the claim that there, you know, this is the period of the end of the African American novel as such.
I want to ask you about the Moten paragraph and just about what's at stake in giving him not the last word per se, right, but getting him to stand in for the dominant position. I mean, he gives you a lot of good lines. The last I found, I have to say, though, in reading your talk, I found your last sentence really hard to remember, that you were talking about his essay rather than your essay in a way that doesn't make any sense, given that I felt that you followed your argument.
Right.
I don't have a more artful way to ask the question than that. Sort of, what's he doing for you there? How would you describe what he's doing? And what seems at stake in asking him to capture the position of the dominant presence?
Yeah, no, you're right that I think that part is as yet underworked. I think the short answer to what he's doing there or why he's there in an important kind of way is that he represents, on the one hand, something that one would have to see as a kind of commitment to Blackness, as an efficacious something, that it does something through and outside of history as such. So he represents someone who produces that. But what was fascinating for me, and I didn't tie the bow as deep as I perhaps could have, in terms of, I was actually surprised, because I hadn't remembered that he had this sort of anti-freedom turn in the work. And I thought, well, actually, that actually makes kind of the point that I was making here, which is to say that it actually does turn out, as Moten shows here, that the kind of commitment that he makes to something like an ontological claim, he's always a little fast and loose about whether it's making an ontological claim. It's making a claim that works ontologically, whether it's sort of ontological or not. I think that's how, maybe that might be how he describes it. I'm not quite sure I would want to say that. But that commitment turns out then to be actually to entail a need to move away from a Freudian account of what the relationship of art, art and object as such. It turns out that you have to have an aesthetic claim here in order to, you know, on his account, in order to forward the, it's a, the ontological claim. So, as I said, he kind of surprised me in that sense by kind of making my argument, you know, in reverse there. It's like, oh, because I'm saying, you know, I'm saying, oh, this is the problem and people haven't acknowledged it. He says, no, you know, I've acknowledged what you're saying, but it's not a problem at all, right? So this shows, I mean, I thought the whole point was to allow a return to him to reiterate the kind of point and the kind of commitments I think that are entailed by making that point, both in terms of understanding what blackness means, whether you think of it as politically or some sort of political ontology, or what it means if you think of it as entailing a kind of a stance with respect to aesthetics. Is that?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thanks for asking.
Question's not necessarily about this talk, but just about conversations that I hear your name being used in. And, so I'm thinking. No, so I'm just curious to hear. I can't go to the party later, and I'd love to ask you that later, so I'm just asking you now. But so Ramon Saldivar talks about you as one of the critics whose work signals a turn to the post-race era. And as far as I know, that's not a term that you use in your writing. So I was wondering if you can just talk about that briefly, how you feel about you know, the way your work is being used in that context, or if you have any thoughts about it at all.
Yeah, I mean, you're right, that's a term I never use, because I'm not entirely, it's never quite entirely clear to me what people who use it want to mark as such. So I have to sort of fill in blanks here, right? And if the claim, well, you could say one way that I'm understanding the, you could say the race era. Well, I'm gonna welcome you back a bit. First, let me say this. If the post-race claim is taken to be a claim that race no longer figures on the social political landscape as a problem as such, then of course that's not anything that I ever say, right? So if that's what is meant by the charge, and you know, it's not a charge I would have to address, but I take it that as I'm engaging this a little further, the claim has to do with the difference between a commitment to the view that race and equality along racial lines is fundamental and foundational something like American society, or whether it is actually something that can be tracked historically as such and must be seen in terms of its relationship and its embeddedness with the production of social inequality over time, and that in some sense its heyday as an organizing social category for the distribution of social goods and the ascription of social lack of social work. Its heyday was in the earlier part, beginning through the latter part of the 19th century through the Jim Crow era as such, and that it no longer operates in that way. And so part of the distinction here, I think, between those of us who want to make a claim about in which you could sort of see something like the waxing and waning of the way in which race can be organized or used to sort of organize centrally, or has been used to organize centrally, American society, so that for me it matters crucially to think about the difference between, say, the Jim Crow era and the present moment, to say something like, you know, you could have now CEO of one of the top grossing corporations now be black American, in a way that you couldn't have in 1950, 1945. And that that is not just if someone would say, you know, an example of some kind of tokenism or something of that sort, it suggests a kind of fundamental change in the way in which race is understood and race is operationalized to produce inequality and social inequality and the like. So that I can say more about that, but the idea here is that the post-race claim, if I'm going to sort of grant it, you know, a little more nuance than I think the claim itself, as I hear it, is expressed, has to do with the extent to which one wants to argue or feels the need to argue the centrality of race as a means of producing and reproducing social worth, and say it's no longer as central and no longer as necessary to the distribution of wealth and social worth in the present as it was under the Jim Crow era, largely because of the means through which the Jim Crow era came to an end. It's important in different ways now, and maybe sort of the more controversial claim here is that it's crucial importance now by virtue of anti-racism and, you know, the line between anti-racism and racism. It's crucial work now tends to be the way in which it underwrites a kind of invasion of political economy as the crucial feature for understanding the reproduction of race, of inequality at the present moment. So the quote that Justin made with Adolf Reed, race, kind of race line is a class politics now, one by which the difference between saying being say being a professor at Duke or Chicago, dealing with sort of the daily discrimination or whatever, what you call microaggressions or whatever, the difference between that and say living in Woodlawn without a job becomes a face because, you know, we're racially the same, right? And that sort of leaves out the structural relation with of political economy in terms of those differences. I said that very badly, but you get the force here.
No, I think then the terms align. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's how he uses you, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ah, sorry for a moment. I think that's right. Okay.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. Probably backtracking a little bit, but I'm wondering, going back to the question of aesthetics and political statements, if aesthetics is the precondition to making a political statement powerful, or a powerful political statement, then how exactly are we qualifying the aesthetics? How are we judging what is a novel in which the politics, because they were preconditioned by the aesthetics, are especially powerful? And like, under what criteria is a good novel being judged under? It, kind of like what Ellison was going by, that a novel has to be a novel in its own stance before it is a political or identitarian statement. If I got that right, and if you could talk a little more about that.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, I think I would have to qualify the way it was the question was asked a bit, but
sure.
I'll take the point because it's important to attend to, and what I was hoping to do was to try to be, and I'm not sure as successful, as historically specific as I could, right, because Ellison's claim has to be understood, I think, in terms of the moment in which he is making that claim. So the political force of his claim would be to say that it actually amounts to a disrespecting of black, you could say, artistic activity. If you simply see this in terms of a continuation of a certain understanding of what folk expression would look like, which is to say, it is the thing that you do by virtue of who you are. You're singing and producing these things, and they're wonderful things, but they have, on this account, no status as a kind of self-conscious expressive production in which you're doing one thing or another. They're of interest solely because they are your unmediated expression of sort of who you are. Right? And And Ellison's claim is that under that understanding of what it is that black people are doing, there can actually be no acknowledgement of the work of art as such, right? That people aren't understood as making choices. And so he's not even quite agreeing that characterization is correct as to the full productions. Because part of what he wants to argue is that the decision to do something in a folk voice as opposed to doing something in a voice that is aware of a certain kind of European tradition, right, that is a decision that's actually more available even among the lower orders, the working class, or even the peasant class, let's say, then one might realize, and one of his favorite tropes is this, an essay called The Little Man in Chihuahua Station, which has his autobiographical accounts when he was in Tuskegee, and he hadn't prepared, he was a musician, played the trumpet, he hadn't prepared for his recital, but he thought he could kind of fake his way through it, and he got appropriately criticized for a lack of facility, and he goes to complain to this woman, Hazel Harrison, who was a student of Prokofiev, and she says to him, you deserve to be criticized, but what you have to keep in mind is this figure he calls the little man at Chihuahua Station. He's that little guy who, this out-of-the-way station who's a nobody coming from nowhere. He says, yes. He says, because in America, because of the presence of broadcast media and unexpected ways in which culture manifests, those who are adept in even the folk idiom know all of the idioms, et cetera. Right? So you always have to have, he says, a kind of respect for your audience that that they know a better version of what you're trying to do because they've heard a better version of what you're trying to do. And therefore, you have to be aware of the technical demands for producing art if you're going to produce even what is good popular art, as such, right? So that's how that claim worked for him. It was really a kind of claim for a certain kind of respect or, consideration. And a call, even in some sense, like a challenge to his fellow black artists to say, hey, there's a lot more we can possibly be doing, as such. I was going to inflect this because the claim at the present moment, the claim is not so much that that in order to be to constitute a powerful political statement, a work of art has to be a work of art in some sense. I mean, one can make powerful political statements in any ways that one can at this point. The claim at the current moment would be something like, and I'd have to probably elaborate this at greater length, right? The claim at the current moment is that, and this is not a claim like for all time, as such, right? It's to say at the current moment, it actually turns out that while maybe in a different moment, the insistence on something like the autonomy of art would read differently. The claim at the current moment is that because of the status of the neoliberal commitment as such, it is under these conditions that a claim for the autonomy of art can actually look different with respect to its critical role in terms, diagnosing the moment of capitalism that we're under. So it's not, none of these claims would be made in terms of this is what always happens, right? So there would be a kind of commitment to a sort of historical attendant, historicization of the moment, but the idea here would be think about, because Nicholas Brown you mentioned earlier as someone who has worked really interestingly on the, possibility of work of art and, under the commodity system in which we're at, and he's got this kind of really funny essay about, the film Avatar, the creatures, the Na'vi, who have sexual relations via, like, their tails or something. And someone asks Cameron, if this is how you imagine sort of the sexual life of the Na'vi, why do the female Na'vis have breasts? Because like there's nothing in the anatomy that you've imagined, in the world that you've imagined, which would dictate the kind of appearance of the Na'vi women as sort of recognized women. And he says something like, you've got to sell a lot of seats. No, it's explicitly right. And he says, and so sex sells, so the breasts go in. Which is to say, I could, with the apparatus that you have, you could actually, you know, reshape the human figure in a different way. But he says, well, it's, and so part of the point there being that if you want to sort of produce a kind of account of the aesthetic structure, you can say an account of the aesthetic structure would have to say that what determines what goes in is the law of representation that you establish when you decide to represent the world in a certain way. So you say, you know, you produce, you put yourself under a kind of law. This goes back to the James, right? When he's really upset with Trollope and says, you know, I can give this thing any turn I want. He says, absolutely not. Because once you commit to a kind of logic of representation, you're like in the story, you're bound by that. To say that you can do anything you want is actually to make the wrong kind of argument. And so to do that, to make that kind of commitment, would be putting yourself in a position on, you know, on this account to understanding the, you know, the art commodity, right, the art work, as not subject to the laws of commodification, which would say, well, the thing that you want in there is the thing that's going to, you know, accumulate adolescent men into the seeds, because they're going to want to see, you know, they like to see, you know, whatever speculative version of the naked human female body is, but that's what they would like to see. So it would be that kind of point, the point being that at a certain moment, a commitment to the aesthetic object can actually open up the possibility of thinking a different way. But it would not be a kind of claim that you would want to make for all time and in all places as such, right? Because there are moments when that commitment might work and work a different moment.
And I think that'll have to be the last question.
No, that's okay.
All right. There will be more to ask during the Q&A. So we should have coffee and snacks out on the table here. Let's all thank Kenneth Warren for